To carry you through the rough spots before you, teamwork is needed. We'll fight and endure and win together.
In this war, there were no draft dodges, no Goldbricks. Every man wanted to be in the service.
You know, I bet it would be more fun shooting Japs than dead.
And every woman was glad when he joined.
You've been enlisted.
Well, you knew it was going to happen sooner or later.
Oh, you look wonderful in that uniform.
Not any better than the rest of the fellas. We all have the same tailor.
Danny's enlisted.
Well, that's wonderful. A son who does it the hard way. Where is he?
Hiya, Pop.
Oh, there are a million fellas down there. Give anything to be in our shoes right now.
Gee, I hope this is a long war. I want to get in it, too.
Why do you want to join this outfit?
My brother died at Pearl Harbor.
My sister was caught by the Japanese in Manila.
I fought in Spain. I fought in Greece. I haven't been in a fight yet. I just don't like Japs.
There were no cowards in this war. The best news a serviceman could get was that he was going into battle.
We're through pulling punches. Our mission is accomplished. From here on in, we fight.
Hey, we're off, aren't we?
Yeah!
Oh, bomb me, Daddy! Ain't through the block!
Ah, ha, ha.
I guess this is it, sir.
This is it.
18 Mitzi attack bombers, 3 points to your right, altitude about 15,000.
Well, what do you know? Only 3-1. That won't even wake me up.
And the bravery of the men who went to war was equaled only by the women they left behind.
Bye, Flyer.
I'll be back.
Bye, honey. I even like your hat.
Even now, knowing how sentimental and square and corny it is, it still grabs you just as it grabbed the nation then. Hollywood showed us how to say goodbye, how to fight, how to sacrifice, how to serve. Gone were the movies of the 30s with their screwball rich people, their fast-talking heroines, their wisecracks about banks and government and unemployment. The war canceled all criticism. And on orders from the Goldwyns, the Mayors, the Warners, all the immigrant studio heads who had built our vision of America in the first place, a new and total wholesomeness pervaded Hollywood's America. It was decided that the true character of the nation was just nice.
I want you to meet my granddaughter.
Tessa?
This is Sergeant Eric Moore.
Hello.
Hello.
Thank you for coming.
I'm sorry, but I think there's...
This is one day that you don't have to think. The Osbournes are going to take care of everything for you today. Aren't we, children?
Yes, we're going to have the best time.
Strawberry shortcake for dessert and everything.
You can fish from a boat if you like.
Good.
I better call them off.
Oh, no. I know I'll wake up in a minute. Things like this don't happen to a lug like me, so just let me dream on a while.
Can we go out before dinner, Tessa? Is it all right for sail?
It still looks like rain.
Look, the sun's coming out.
What are you going to do when we get back home, Thatcher?
Oh, I have a girl in Billings, sir. I'm going to marry her if we get back.
Oh, we'll get back, all right. When are you going to get married, Bob?
Oh, when I find somebody like Ella.
Well, you know, the four of us.
You know, when this is over, I'd like to get me a small ranch. Something that would run about, 40, 50 head of cattle. You know, a guy's got himself a place, he doesn't have to worry about anything.
And with a little hunting near?
Oh, sure, that's easy.
There were no demonstrations, No complaints in nice America. Even the housing shortage seemed kind of like fun.
You hear about the apartment?
Yeah, it says half an apartment. Is it rented?
You look like a high type, clean cut, nice young fella. No, it's not rented. Come in. It's really only half of an apartment, but it's not rented.
Good.
What's your name?
Carter.
Bill Carter?
Joe Carter.
I used to know a fellow named Bill Carter.
Wasn't me.
Don't you suppose I know that?
What'd you ask him?
I guess I know what Bill Carter looked like.
Not like me.
Oh, then you know Bill Carter.
No, I don't. But he sounds like a great guy.
In the new nice America, women wanted only their husbands and babies. Although half the women in the country went to work during the war, very few movies portrayed this aspect of their lives. For women in the 40s, working was very much like sex. If you enjoyed it, you were bad. Women, good women, were depicted as waiting, writing, worrying, or pregnant.
What are you going to do, Ellen?
Oh, I'm just going to sit around and have a baby.
A baby? Ellen, why didn't you tell us?
I don't know. I guess I just never thought of a way till now. As it turns out, it wasn't hard to tell at all. Well, I'm going to have one, too.
What?
Really? Oh, gee, I think it's wonderful. George and I have talked about it, but, well, with him away and all, I guess I'm just too scared.
I thought I would be, too, but, well, Ted and I figured that everything since Pearl Harbor's just been so much velvet. And then I guess that if anything should happen to him, only I know nothing will, I'd have the baby, and that would be a little bit of Ted still living.
Volunteer work was acceptable, but only if it involved sacrifice. Sacrifice was a big thing in the 40s movies, and those who didn't sacrifice were enthusiastically torn to pieces by those who did.
What did I hear about you working at the hospital?
I'm a nurse's aide.
A nurse's aide? Oh, what a revolting idea for an unmarried girl of your age.
Well, of course, our whole code of living seems to be completely ignored these days, and possibly it's none of my business.
You're quite right, Mrs. Hawkins. It is none of your business.
I must say, Lieutenant, or Commander, or whatever you are, the Navy hasn't improved your manners any.
Well, please, Tony. Please, Emily. It's the Colonel's birthday, and we're trying to have a party.
I meant no offense to you, Jane. I simply feel that well-brought-up young girls shouldn't be permitted to have such intimate contact with all sorts of...
All sorts of boys who've lost their arms and legs? They're young, too, lots of them. But they weren't too young for that, Mrs. Hawkins. And I don't think breeding entered into it, either.
Bravo, Jane.
I don't care to debate it with you, Jay. But surely there are women who are more suited to such...
That's just it. There aren't women more suited. And women who might help, like you, Mrs. Hawkins, think you're doing your part if you attend a canteen dance for your own pleasure.
You're tired, honey. Why don't you go upstairs?
Yes, Mother. But there's just one or two more things I want to say.
Come on, darling. She's not worth it.
We're not the girls. We're simply helping with the wreckage.
All right, Bree, let's go play with our dolls.
Don't worry, Mrs. Hawkins. Please don't worry if our precious, well-bred hands come in contact with those mangled bodies. We'll survive, even when they don't.
Anne Hilton, how did this happen that you would permit a child of yours to talk that way without so much...
Without so much as what? Thank heaven my child had the courage to say to you what should have been said long ago. And let me add that I'm ashamed. Ashamed that I've put up with you, that I've even known you.
Yes, we were the good guys, all right. And as good as we were, that's how bad they were.
Your mothers were slimy rats!
Wake, up and talk, dirty crawling rat!
We are not animals, we are men. That is the foundation of law. You cannot win. Where are your courts? Your judges and your juries.
We want wine, not tea.
Wine?
Yes, wine.
Oh, no wine, huh? Then where are your women? There are other things than wine.
In exactly 30 minutes, the first 40 hostages will be executed. Sign all four copies.
The Japanese will win. He wears wood fiber clothes, cardboard shoes. He cheerfully eats one-third of his usual diet. He works 14 hours a day, 7 days a week. And our soldiers, ask your troops at Bataan. We do not leave any place that we want. You must kill us. We will win this war because we are willing to sacrifice 10 million lives.
Paradoxically, all the Japanese villains in the 40s war movies were played by Chinese. Because right after the war began, we had rounded up all the Japanese Americans who had lived in the states bordering the Pacific and put them in relocation centers. In this slickly made documentary, narrated by Milton Eisenhower, we see the movie version of the Japanese relocation, a version in which the Japanese, who were in reality devastated by their imprisonment, seem not to mind it at all.
They gathered in their own churches and schools, and the Japanese themselves cheerfully handled the enormous paperwork involved in the migration. Civilian physicians made preliminary medical examinations. Government agencies helped in 100 ways. They helped the evacuees find tenants for their farms. They helped businessmen lease, sell, or store their property. Now, this aid was financed by the government, but quick disposal of property often involved financial sacrifice for the evacuees. Now the actual migration got underway. The Army provided fleets of vans to transport household belongings and buses to move the people to assembly centers. The evacuees cooperated wholeheartedly. The many loyal among them felt that this was a sacrifice they could make in behalf of America's war effort.